Hey, what's up, you amazing hackers? Hope you're all doing well today. So today I really want to talk about web application filters and what they're all about, because a couple of you guys have asked me what kind of techniques you can use to do these filter evasion techniques. But to know that for real, you have to know what WAF is like. So today I want to talk a little bit about the inner workings of it, how it works specifically. First of all, we need to have a firewall. Let's just draw a few things here. So let's say we have an actor here, and this actor is going to try and make a GET request to the slash login page. Okay, simple. Then we can create a web application filter in front of our website, which is just basically going to be like this. This is our web application filter firewall. I keep saying filter, but of course it's firewall. So this is our WAF. Now, what this thing is going to do is it's going to inspect any traffic that comes from the internet, like a GET request, a POST request, and we call those a request and a response. So what this specific web application firewall is going to do is it's going to inspect web application traffic. Simple as that. If any traffic from a web application comes in or towards web application, it's going to inspect it, but also from the web application to the user, there's a possibility to inspect. So let's say we have our web application here, pretty big web application. Our guy here wants to make a GET request. That's possible. He's going to go through the WAF first. And what the WAF is basically going to consist of is two things. You're going to have a module which is going to try and inspect. So this is responsible for all of the inspection itself. Like, is this a GET request? Is this a POST request? Is this whatever? But before that, so before this even happens, there's a different stage. So let's make this specific stage here. And this stage, we're going to do all of our checks. We'll talk a little bit about that later, how those checks work specifically. But what you need to know now is that checks come after the first stage. In the first stage, we're going to determine if we're even talking about web application traffic, and we're going to determine what kind of traffic we have in here. Now, it's not going to be very precise. This is just a very simple application. It's going to see, do we have a request here or do we have a response here? And do we have web application traffic going through this? So I'm going to call this the inspector, and then your web traffic. So let's erase this and let's erase, go like this, there we go. Now your traffic is going to go through your inspector first. Your inspector is going to say, okay, this is a request. It's going to the web server, and then it's going to pass it on towards the checks. Now, the inspector itself, we're talking about web application firewalls, like Mod Security, like Akami, I think is one. There's several different WAFs out there, but what they all have in common is that this inspector is a very basic shell, and it's only built to get a request and get see if it's a response or a request, and that's about it. All of the good stuff happens in these checks here, and in these checks you basically have a list of rules, many lists of rules even, which we call rule sets. So you have one rule set, you have another rule set, you have another rule set, you have another rule set. These rule sets are basically just configuration files. And in these rule sets, they can work in two ways. They can work on a blacklist basis or a whitelist basis. Now, the easiest one is going to be a blacklist basis, because then you can allow all of the traffic and you only filter out the traffic which actually meets one of these checks. So if I send a login request and there's something in these checks that triggers, I'm going to deny the request and maybe even log a message about it. Okay, simple as that. Blacklist, it might seem simple, but if you really think about it, there are a million different attacks that you can create. So it's going to be very difficult to cover them all. Now, we can also do whitelist based checks, and we have two choices there. We can either do actual literal checks and see if whatever comes in literally matches whatever is in our checklists and our rule sets. Or we can also do a pattern-based check, We can see, for example, we don't have to define things very strictly. We can say, okay, I want a parameter of this size, like username should be a alphanumerical input parameter. It should be 1 to 46 characters and all of that stuff. You don't exactly have to put real exact things in here. You can basically build real cool things and you have a lot of flexibility. But whitelist based testing, of course, is going to be a lot more difficult because you're going to have to foresee all of the possibilities that your application has, which is extremely difficult. So if you guys really want to know how these things work internally, I would advise you to look up the mod security by OWASP and the core security rule set, because these things contain basically a very good coverage for most companies out there, and the mod security is going to be the inspector that we talked about here. And if we talk about the core rule set, we're talking about these checks that happen over here. So the core rule set is basically where all of the magic happens, and as you can see, it's quite difficult because there are thousands of attacks that can happen and you have to foresee most of them. Covering all of them is not possible. And the weird thing is, as soon as a new rule gets added to the rule set, hackers start trying to figure it out and trying to figure a way around it, of course. And since the core rule set is easily reachable, you can easily check which rules are included. So it's like a cat and mouse game. The developers of the core rule set develop a new rule and the hackers try to hack it. It's basically as simple as that. We as bug bounty hunters try to get around these checks here. Now, there are checks that are basic, like these standard checks that are built in, but the developer or the administrator can also add their own checks or completely replace the basic ones with their own checks. Like, for example, we might have a check in the core rule set which checks that the login page is with a slash login in the URI. It might even check that there is a parameter username, a parameter password, but the developer might think that's all a little bit too much and they say, oh, let's just trust everybody and let's just ask a get login and then it's all good. And in that case, we can get around it very easily, but there are also ways where we have to be a little bit more creative, like we could base64 encode our values, or we could try and figure our way around these checks. Now, the easiest way is just to go and look at these rule sets and see what they entail. So just see if you can find something about it. If you can't find anything about the rule set, you're going to have to define it yourself a little bit. You're going to have to throw stuff at your web application and see what gets filtered and see what gets through. By that, you'll be able to build like a little bit of a schedule of like, okay, this might be in the rule set, this might be in the rule set, and you might be able to gather an attack that way. So thank you very, very much for listening. Thank you very, very much for watching. I hope you guys found this informative. This is basically how a web application firewall works. You have your inspector, you have your checks, you have your rule sets, you have your rules in those rule sets as well. And that's what gets checked by the traffic. And if you use blacklist type filtering, anything that gets on the list and is from the request that is on the list gets basically dropped. Sometimes a message gets logged. If it's whitelist based filtering, the request has to be on the rule set to get through. Otherwise, it will not get through. Thank you very much for listening. One last thing I wanted to show you guys is I have my red shirt on. Check it out, real cool. If you guys want one, you can buy it in the description as well. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you guys in the next video. Bye bye, amazing hackers. See you later.